the US. And just to kind of state the obvious, international interest in Danish welfare systems has been growing since the 2008 crash, and many leaders are kind of looking to Denmark for solutions in welfare provision. And why wouldn't they? Denmark constantly ranks at the top of indices on equality in gender, income, and opportunity, giving us the cafe latte fathers that we all know and love. The transformation is taking here too, led by aging demographics, tightening budgets, and advancing in technology. We've recently seen the cuts to the architecture school and other kind of welfare institutions. We constantly fed the line that welfare is unaffordable, unreliable, and unrealistic. But over the same period of time, we've also seen the rise of these mega platforms like Google, Facebook, and Amazon, which offer us new ways to organize. They connect us up to friends and services, providing the logistics which make our lives easier. We've also become familiar with these kind of city platforms that have replaced taxis and hotels in many parts of the world and connect us up to services in real physical space. But platform technology isn't only impacting the stuff that you buy on your mobile phone. So we're wondering about what the other institutions that are the kind of backbone of our Nordic lives and how they might be affected by these transformations. So what might a platform for welfare look like? We've explored the ways that communication platforms like Google and Facebook are mining our data in previous events. And we know that kind of the knowledge amassed about us puts them in a really good position to make customized services. And our question tonight is, what might this mean for welfare? So we all know this classic welfare triangle, the kind of independency between market, state, and citizens. But what the addition of the platform does is to connect people up together in new ways. It allows for the kind of collaboration between different groups without the need for top-down mediation, instead establishing a peer-to-peer connection and kind of bypassing the authority. In doing so, the platform also breaks down this distinction between professional and amateur, turning us all into service providers and content producers. And Denmark might just be a good place to start with this, the kind of conversation of status platform and platform of state, because you all have the CPR card in your wallet, which is already a very effective platform connecting you up to the state. We use it kind of every day to access libraries, healthcare, a whole range of services, and most of us actually never even think about it. We did this mapping in the very first In Between Economies event, looking at all of the many places across the city where you actually use this card. And our question is kind of, what else could you use your CPR to unlock? Is there some kind of extra connection or relationship that we could connect to? So to bring these quite abstract questions down to something more concrete, we wanted to show a couple of quick examples of where platform or kind of new organizational modes are being used in welfare already. So first up is this Bertzorg model in the Netherlands, which is dreamt up by a nurse called Jos de Blok. And across the world, the Bertzorg model is kind of being emulated and being seized on by policymakers as a means of cutting bureaucracy and improving the length and the quality of care. And the innovation is really quite simple, analog in fact. This is how the management structure looked before, with the kind of single manager controlling a group of nurses and connecting them to the patient. Kind of top-down model, centrally organized and controlled. And this is what the Bertzorg structure looks like. It's a solution which draws on the characteristics of the platform, but doesn't even necessarily need that technology, allowing nurses to self-organize, freeing them from the kind of management control that's traditional, and unleashing their individual agency. And it means that those nurses have gone from spending about a third of their time on a patient to around double that. And the innovation also reduced the patient recovery time on average by 40%, saving the state in turn quite a lot of money. Now flying over to the UK, Casserole Club is an app kind of developed by FutureGov, which is a volunteering platform that allows people to sign up as cooks and share a portion of home-cooked food reducing social isolation among older people and kind of connecting people up in the neighbourhood. Also in the UK, Care Rooms is working with the NHS to pilot the model where homeowners rent out a spare room in their house to a person recovering from surgery in hospital, and this is at a cost of around 500 kroner. But in effect, it's the health service paying here, because by opening up the provision of the service to individuals to provide, the platform model kind of allows welfare to be commodified. So we have this kind of language of earning extra income and no care experience required, and it kind of makes us question what the service is for. But as a group of four architects, we're always curious on the kind of spatial effect of these transformations. And we know that the classical city was organized by a strict hierarchy in which the institutions of hospitals and town halls, schools and banks kind of created these focal points in the urban grid. But digital connectivity flattens this hierarchy so that the institution becomes kind of less pivotal in its position. So if the hospital and school and town hall were the set pieces of the classical welfare city, what could be the set pieces of this one? But it seems like we always need these physical spaces to kind of accommodate our desire for collectivity. So we're questioning more what might these look like in the future. We're hoping to explore